In re Perryman, Thomas P. Kelly, appearing for appellant, David P. Gardner, appearing for appellee.
Good morning. Mr. Kelly, would you like to reserve some time for rebuttal?
Yes, please, Your Honor. I'd like to reserve 5 minutes for rebuttal.
5 minutes,
great. If you could please warn me at 10 minutes, I can't see the clock on the system I have.
Okay, when we finish 10 minutes, I'll try to warn you.
Okay.
Go ahead, please.
Thank you. May it please the court. Today, the present appeal arises from the denial of a motion for contempt for violation of the automatic stay. The particulars of this are well delineated in the brief. What we have here is that the appellant in a divorce case was seeking $7,000 in attorney's fees, $3,000 in sanctions, and also to compel my client, the appellant, and or the clerk of the divorce court to execute a deed of trust pursuant to an agreement that preceded the bankruptcy.
Counsel, that all sounds good in the windup, but that existed pre-petition, correct?
Well, there was proceedings, Judge, before.
Well, I mean, the motion. My understanding is that judgment had been entered. Your client did not execute the note or the deed of trust, and there was a motion filed to compel that pre-petition. Prior to the hearing, bankruptcy was filed, correct?
Well, on March 26th, the appellee filed the request for order. April 18th of 2019, the bankruptcy case was filed. What follows is six hearings on that.
So, again, that sounds very advocate. Those hearings were for continuances, correct?
No, they weren't. It was not a request for a continuance. It was a hearing on the motion itself. And then at the hearing, there would be a discussion of the status of the bankruptcy case, and then counsel for the appellee, requested continuance after continuance. We met and conferred, told them that we needed to stop, and hearings kept going. Hearings kept going in this matter even after this appeal was filed.
Let me ask you this. What should the appellee have done to comply with the automatic stay?
Drop the matter from the calendar. The motion would remain on calendar with the state court, and the matter could be re-noticed if the bankruptcy case was dismissed or if relief from stay was granted. That would have been the proper course, in my opinion, is to seek relief from stay and to move forward with the motion if this is what they wanted to do. In addition, the appellee filed an adversary proceeding in this case on exactly the same issues.
Does this state court permit what we would in Hawaii would call a continuance until moved on, where it's just indefinitely taken off calendar? Is that permitted in the state court?
In the context of when an adversary proceeding is filed, generally speaking, yes. The Sonoma County judges will take it off calendar and let the matter sit pending a resolution of the stay. I've seen that over and over again. This is my home county. But again, a notice of stay was filed with the state court as well and was served on appellee. There was no question that the appellee had notice of the stay. There's no question that the stay applied. There are no exceptions. In addition to that, appellee in their opposition brief has conceded essentially all of the factual elements we've pled, which means that only the bankruptcy court could have listened to this matter. As I outlined in my reply brief, the subject matter jurisdiction is exclusively the bankruptcy court. The adversary proceeding was the correct way to proceed on this matter, to get both, if they wanted sanctions and attorney's fees, but most especially this deed of trust. Because
how did that arise, though, counsel? Because all of this is largely undisputed. When I went back and I examined the declaration of support, it attached, what I probably incorrectly called the docket with the minute, it would just matter continued. And then the last item was a little more substantive, but I didn't see anything that detailed what happened or described. I mean, put it another way, at the very first call of that motion, what was said, and where is that in the record that we know what was said? Was it pressed as a hearing on the motion, or really did the parties come up and say, Your Honor, the matter's in bankruptcy, this has to be continued?
Well, first of all, counsel for my client, Brian Lance, appeared at that hearing. And he informed the bankruptcy, the state court, that there was a bankruptcy filing.
Was that disputed?
No, it's not disputed. My client incurred attorney's fees for all those appearances Mr. Lanz had to make post-petition.
What, for what purpose, though? What was, and how do we know what the purpose of that proceeding in state court was? Right? Well, it was continued, all right? And you're saying it was continued for an actual substantive matter. To us, it appears that it could have been continued and probably was continued as a status just so the administrative function to continue to monitor where that was going.
On one of the hearings, Your Honor, the it denotes that counsel for appellee appeared and requested or gave us update as to the bankruptcy status and requested a continuance. We only have the minute orders. There wasn't a court reporter for any of these. So we don't have that information. But Mr. Lanz's declaration, who was the counsel for my client at all of these hearings, is pretty straightforward, that it's a hearing on the request for order. It wasn't a request for continuance. At any time, appellee could have dropped this matter from the calendar simply by calling the judicial assistant or the clerk or filing a request to take it off calendar. The motion would have remained on the docket. It would have remained a live matter.
I'm looking at Mr. Lance's declaration at document 9-9, page 2 of 24. On March 26, 29, opposing counsel analyzed and filed a request for order against Ms. Perryman seeking to affect the execution. That's the request for order. We filed a notice of stay. The hearing on the request for order was continued until November 4th. The hearing was continued May 26th. On November 16, 2020, Ann Larson requested the matter be set for hearing again on December 16th. What in that is telling us that this is substantive versus administrative?
The first sentence that you just read there saying that seeking to execute on the request for order. He says it right there.
That was before the bankruptcy was filed.
Yeah.
That's, no, hold on. That was when the motion was filed.
Which was before the bankruptcy.
March 26, 2019.
But the hearing is after the bankruptcy is filed.
But you're missing the connection.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I understand, like, how do we know what happened in those hearings? I understand your question. We don't have a court reporter's transcript for that. It doesn't exist.
Isn't this your burden?
Our burden is to show that the stay was in effect, that the creditor knew about it, and that the creditor moved ahead willfully. Endlessly continuing hearings on a motion for sanctions, a motion for attorney's fees, an attempt to execute on a deed of trust is expressly barred by the automatic stay.
Why? Why is that? That isn't what the Supreme Court, I mean, excuse me. What the Ninth Circuit held in Roach as to the foreclosures, it held that merely maintaining the status quo, not harassing, interfering, or gaining an advantage, didn't violate the stay.
We're dealing with 362A4 here. That you're talking about continuing a foreclosure sale. Any act to create, perfect, or enforce any lien against property of the estate. This was expressly seeking to get that lien. It's in the paperwork. It's right there.
So are you saying that any request to continue was a violation of the automatic stay?
There would be another hearing.
No. You need to answer the question, please.
If you're asking why, let me ask you this then. The way I would respond to that is, if it's a request for continuance, why isn't that continuance in the pleadings? Why is there actually a hearing?
Because there was a hearing already set.
Correct. And then we have that happen a second time, a third time, a fourth time, a fifth time, a sixth time.
Right.
And I guess what we don't know from the record is, for all we know, the attorney for the creditor could have showed up at that first hearing and said, Your Honor, we'd like to have an indefinite continuance because this is in bankruptcy. And the judge says, no, I think we need to keep tabs on this. I need you back here in 60 days or whatever. I mean, for all we know from the record, that could very well have happened.
That's not accurate. I believe it's the fourth hearing on November 16th where it explicitly states that Ann Larson requested a continuance. It was not an order of the court.
And what's wrong with that?
Because again, it's any act to continue or to commence or continue any effort to collect on a debt or enforce a lien against the property of the bankruptcy estate is stayed. And we're having hearing after hearing after hearing. It should have stopped. And then we have an adversary proceeding going on at the same time on the same matter.
This is a Chapter 13, correct?
Correct.
My understanding is that a lot of Chapter 13s don't complete, don't result in a discharge, and are ultimately dismissed. So why isn't the administrative function of ascertaining what the bankruptcy status a valid function of the state court's management of its docket?
Right. I see that all the time where the court puts in a minute order saying, we're going to have a meeting where I want you to advise me as to the bankruptcy status. Okay. And that happens frequently, but there's no hearings with that. You normally there'll be, for example, a case management conference statement or some other very, very limited pleading saying the bankruptcy is still pending. I see that all the time. It's not what happened here.
Well, I'm sorry. I just want to remind you there's 5 minutes left, but Judge Grant has a question for you.
Yeah. So is the difference that it costs you less to respond to a case management statement than run into court and say, yeah, the bankruptcy is still pending? Is that the difference? Because it seems the same thing to be filing a notice that says the bankruptcy is still pending as showing up in court and saying, yes, Your Honor, the bankruptcy is still pending.
Because in that instance, there's a hearing. The attorney, Mr. Lance,
it costs you more because the attorney has to go downtown to the courthouse. Is that why?
Correct. And also at any one of these hearings, we don't know what's happening. An order could be entered even though the stay is in place.
But isn't it void if it violates the stay? If the judge said, I don't care, I'm tired of this, I'm entering an order that the deed is done. Isn't that void? So it's not a risk to you?
Wait a minute. Now we're talking attorney's fees and sanctions as well.
That's what you're talking about already.
I know. And all of this could happen if our client, my client doesn't spend the money and send an attorney in, there'll be no one there to see what happens and no one to report back. And that's the risk he takes. You're right. It would be void. I completely agree with you. However,
I'm eating up your time, though. So if you want to stop.
No, that's okay. Unless there's another question I can address from the panel, I'll leave it at that and reserve the balance of my time. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Mr. Gardner.
Good morning, Your Honors. You know, I think the brief set it out pretty clearly. There are a few points I'd like to make in addition. The first one is that the appellant doesn't cite a single case to cite it to support his position. It's basically asking for new law. And I think the panel's right on with this is just continuances. There's no violation of the stay. It is a Chapter 13. We have a pending motion to dismiss next month. I think it's number 7. Judge Spraker, you're completely correct about how these things don't often survive. I think we're on the 7th.
Well, let me ask you this. Could you or couldn't you, in this particular state court, have filed a notice saying, this defendant's in bankruptcy, please take this matter off calendar and reset it once you're advised that the bankruptcy stay has been terminated? Could you have done that in Sonoma?
Your Honor, I haven't seen that, but I don't practice family law, and so to be honest, I'm not sure. My co-counsel, Ann Larson, was the one who was dealing with the state court issues. I'm arguing this because it's in a bankruptcy context. But I have, I'll tell you, seen many times where it does exactly this, that it gets put over 3-6 months, we come back, say it's still going, we put it over again, and it's come totally normal, as Judge Montali pointed out. And also that, you know, the dischargeable debts don't usually include fines, penalties, and sanctions, which is what's the issue here. So it may not be dischargeable at all. And at the last position, I requested no sanctions be against us because it's not at all clear that we had any intention to violate things. It appears to us this is the way it's always done. There was no intention to violate the stay, only to continue. And as a final point, I think that the appeal has to fail on the record. As you pointed out, there's nothing to indicate what was actually said during the various hearings. There was no court reporter, but that's an option in Sonoma County courts that somebody can ask to bring in their own court reporter if they want to create a record. And so on appeal, you don't have that evidence before you.
Does the record support any inference as to what was happening there? Who was requesting the continuances? You know, was it the court that said, I want this, you know, in 6 months or however long? Or is there anything in the record that establishes that fact?
I don't think there's a clear indication in the record. My understanding is sometimes it went one way, sometimes it went the other. We show up and just what we want to do. Let's continue it because it's still in bankruptcy. Another time the judge said, if it's still in bankruptcy, great, we'll continue it. Not much difference there. And, you know, unless you have questions, that's all I really wanted to say.
Any questions? Okay. All right. Very good.
Thank you.
Mr. Kelly, back to you.
Thank you, Your Honor. I want to point something out, that there is nothing about what the appellee was doing that's subject to any exception to the automatic stay. Specifically, there was no spousal support issues here. The trial court's ruling was that this happens all the time in family law matters. And there are exceptions, custody, support, things like that. In this particular instance, there was an order prior to the bankruptcy where it specifically says, and I'm quoting it now, spousal support was terminated as to both parties. That's record number 9. It's paragraph 4, exhibit A, page 12. I have it cited in the record. But beyond that, counsel for appellee just identified the problem. We're now having these hearings where there's no court reporter. And my client will now have to hire a court reporter and an attorney to go in there to establish the record. Further, I believe it's the November 16th hearing. There's a minute order where it specifically says that it was Ann Larson that requested the continuances, not an order of the court. Though that happened over and over and over again. And here's the problem. Are we going to...
It didn't happen over and over again, because Ms. Larson's declaration submitted in opposition states that the court, she requested longer hearings, and that was the court that was setting them on for shorter.
Well, we dispute that. And Mr. Lanz...
Well, where's that in the record?
Mr. Lanz's declaration has that information, as I recall.
Okay.
But again, wait a minute. But you're getting into factual matters that the trial court made no determination of. There was no ruling on it at all. Simply said, this is all totally ordinary. There was no factual findings by the court in this case. None.
It goes back to Judge Brand's point. What should have been done by the state court? I mean, you wanted to just lay fallow.
Well,
state court disagrees and wants something. Your argument is that something violates the automatic stay. It doesn't really matter if it's written or if it's, you know, come and appear. That's an act either way, right?
It absolutely is an act. And that's the problem. That's why we're here today, is because the creditor continued to move forward this in the state court.
And
litigation.
It doesn't matter if the state court required it. You're saying our order should say state courts, once notice of bankruptcy is given, must sit.
Okay, hold on. That's where you're reading something in the record that's not there. I have never seen an order from the court where it says, I, judge of the state court, want this to be heard again. There's nothing in this record that says that. Nothing. It is Ann Larson that is continuing to move the ball forward. These hearings continue again and again and again at her request. She could have taken it off calendar at any time. And the motion doesn't
go away. If the court let her, right.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you, Judge Brandt.
I said if the court let her take it off calendar, we don't know whether they would have let her take it off or not.
Okay, well, wait a minute. The minute orders reflect, and I quote this in my brief, that Ms. Larson is the one requesting the continuance, not the court. So she's the one doing this. There's no reason to have 6 hearings over the period of nearly a year while there's a pending Chapter 13.
You're putting a lot of emphasis on the word, on the phrase last hearing continued per counsel's request.
Right. It's not the court.
It's all from the inception of the original motion.
But she's requesting these continuances. There's no need to continue it. The motion is on file. It can remain on the docket without a hearing date, pending the resolution of the automatic stay. That happens all the time, especially, for example, motions for attorney's fees, motions for possession of collateral, all of these things. Collections actions are particularly emblematic of this. For example, all these credit card cases that we have, tens of thousands of them. There will be CMCs, everything, and it comes up and nobody even files a CMC statement. Court just makes a one-line entry.
I'm sorry, I'm going to stop you because you're a little bit over time, but I do have one question I want to ask, even though you're over time, and that is, you're not contending, are you, that the creditor in this case had an obligation to withdraw the underlying motion?
Well, that remember, it's a stay, so everything just stops.
Right.
And so the motion's
I just
on
wanted
file.
To, I thought that was and, your position. I just wanted to make right, sure I understood these, that correctly.
The way I explain to my clients is that the case is frozen in amber until the bankruptcy court judge says otherwise, and that's precisely what didn't happen here.
Okay,
is that they kept being hearing after hearing after hearing. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you very much. All right, the matter is submitted. You'll be hearing from us with a written decision. Thank you. Madam Clerk, you can call the next case, please.